Good morning and welcome to worship at Roberts Park United Methodist Church. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I'm Pastor Andrew, and it is my pleasure on behalf of the congregation of Roberts Park to welcome you to our service this morning. Wherever you are watching us from online, it is our prayer that today you will feel that even the smallest action undertaken in the love of God will bear fruit in ways we cannot always imagine. Image and imagination play a big part in our sermon today. And I want to begin this service by showing you three pictures in a moment. As you look at them on screen, I want you to note what you first see. We'll come back to them in a little while. Here are the three pictures. Dick Smith is our liturgist today.
Please join me in the call to worship. Though there is strife in the world, yet we will seek God. When our hearts grow heavy and the burdens are overbearing, we will turn to the Lord. God is with us in all things. We can place our trust in the God of love and hope. Amen. Please join in the prayer of approach. Lord, you place before us the images of the small, the tiny mustard seed, the grain of yeast, the little treasure, and remind us that we, though we think of ourselves as small, are not insignificant in your kingdom. Open our hearts and our spirits to you in thankful remembrance of the ways in which we can serve you throughout all our lives. Amen.
Oh,
Our Old Testament reading comes from the book of Ezekiel, the 17th chapter. The word of the Lord came to me, O mortal, propound a riddle, and speak an allegory to the house of Israel. Say, thus says the Lord God, a great eagle with great wings and long pinions, rich in plumage of many colors, came to the Lebanon. He took the top of the cedar, broke off its topmost shoot. He carried it to a land of trade, set it in a city of merchants. Then he took a seed from the land, placed it in fertile soil. A plant by abundant waters, he set it like a willow twig. It sprouted and became a vine, spreading out, but lo, its branches turned toward him, its roots remained where it stood. So it became a vine. It brought forth branches, put forth foliage. There was another great eagle, with great wings and much plumage. And see, this vine stretched out its roots toward him. It shot out its branches toward him, so that he might water it. From the bed where it was planted, it was transplanted to good soil by abundant waters, so that it might produce branches and bear fruit and become a noble vine. Say, thus says the Lord God, will it prosper? Will he not pull up its roots? Will it cause its fruit to rot and wither? Its fresh sprouting leaves to fade? No strong arm or mighty army will be needed to pull it from its roots. When it is transplanted, will it thrive? When the east wind strikes it, will it not utterly wither on the bed where it grew? Then the word of the Lord came to me. Say now to the rebellious house, do you not know what these things mean? Tell them, the king of Babylon came to Jerusalem, took its king and its officials, and brought them back with him to Babylon. He took one of the royal offspring and made a covenant with him, putting him under oath. He had taken away the chief men of the land, so that the kingdom might be humble and not lift itself up, and that by keeping his covenant it might stand. But he rebelled against him by sending ambassadors to Egypt, in order that they might give him horses and a large army. Will he succeed? Can one escape who does such things? Can he break the covenant and yet escape? As I live, says the Lord God, surely in the place where the king resides, who made him king, whose oath he despised, and whose covenant with him he broke, in Babylon he shall die. Pharaoh with his mighty army and great company will not help him in war, when ramps are cast up and siege walls built to cut off many lives. Because he despised the oath and broke the covenant, because he gave his hand and yet did all these things, he shall not escape. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, as I live, I will surely return upon his head my oath that he despised and my covenant that he broke. I will spread my net over him, and he shall be caught in my snare. I will bring him to Babylon and enter into judgment with him there, for the treason he has committed against me. All the pick of his troops shall fall by the sword, and the survivors shall be scattered to every wind. And you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will take a sprig from the lofty top of a cedar. I will set it out. I will break off a tender one from the topmost of its young twigs. I myself will plant it on a high and lofty mountain. On the mountain height of Israel I will plant it, in order that it may produce boughs and bear fruit, and become a noble cedar. Under it every kind of bird will live. In the shade of its branches will nest winged creatures of every kind. All the trees of the field shall know that I am the Lord. I bring low the high tree, I make high the low tree. I dry up the green tree, and make the dry tree flourish. I, the Lord, have spoken. I will accomplish it. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
True art is made noble and religious by the mind producing it. For those who feel it, nothing makes the soul
religious and pure as the attempt to create something perfect.
For God is perfection,
God is perfection,
God is perfection,
God is perfection. Strives after perfection.
Whoever strives after perfection.
Whoever strives after perfection.
Is striving. Is striving. 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 Is striving after.
I want to begin this time together by going back to those three images we saw at the start of our service. The images, of course, are a very clever optical illusion, and we usually start by recognizing the familiar in an image. But if someone points out another way of looking at it, all of a sudden our vision takes in the new image, and our whole perspective on the photo is radically changed. Here is picture one again. What did you see? How many saw a man playing a musical instrument with a lady sitting on a rock? How many of you saw a skull? How many of you saw both, or now see both? In this second image, how many of you saw a woman reading a book with an elderly man standing beside her, and both of them under a stone arch? And how many of you saw a balding elderly man with a big mustache? And how many saw or now see both? And finally, is this man looking at you, or is he sideways on? These are relatively easy optical illusions to see. Some are much harder. But it's the art of taking one perspective and pointing out another in the same image. Laurie Wagner, whose work I acknowledge, calls this re-imaging, although it's really more of a re-imagining of the image at hand. It's the skill to take a familiar image and help people see a different one in the same picture. Will you pray with me? All-seeing God, help us to be the masters of ourselves that we might truly be the servants of others. Take our minds and think through them. Take our lips and speak through them. Take our hands and do your good works. Take our lives and live out your life. Take our hearts and set them on fire with love for you. In a sense, this is the genius of Jesus. Jesus loved re-imaging Scripture. He would take a familiar image or metaphor of Scripture, and then suddenly he would illuminate a new, usually somehow subversive one in its place, and voila, shock, confusion, a shaking up of reality and a shifting of truth. One of those times Jesus does this is with the parable of the mustard seed, a tiny but mighty parable, of course. appearing in all three of the Synoptic Gospels. In Matthew chapter 13, it's in verse 31 and 32, and it says this. Another parable he put before them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it is grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that birds of the air come and perch and nest in its branches." In the parable, Jesus introduces a mustard seed, the tiniest of seeds, but when planted in the field, becomes big enough to wide enough to house birds perching or nesting in its branches. This line alone would have taken people immediately to Ezekiel and God's parable of the cedar tree, but with a significant twist. And there's a big difference between a cedar and a mustard. Here is the cedar of Lebanon, and here is the mustard. The cedar is a huge, strong, sturdy tree that grows in the high mountains of the Lebanon. Some grow to about 100 feet high and 9 feet around. They smell aromatic and they live forever. They tower over everything. They are regal and lofty. Mustard is, well, essentially a field plant that can grow into a small, spindly tree low to the ground. They aren't high or lofty, but they have generation power. The power of numbers, the power to regenerate themselves to the maximum and quickly. Not pretty, not sturdy, not something that you put in your beautiful garden maybe, but hardy and can fill field after field, can grow anywhere and can sustain in any kind of weather. But what does Ezekiel say about the cedar? Ezekiel is telling a story first of what happens when one breaks covenant with God and tries to believe he or she can control their own life and circumstances. Ezekiel verifies only God is truly in charge. Only God can grow a cedar in a place where cedars do not grow. The story tells us that God will take the uppermost branch of the cedar and replant it on the mountain in Israel. Now the cedar is native to the mountainous regions of the Lebanon in biblical times. Although its strong aromatic wood was exported to various lands in order for it to be used in shipbuilding, funeral boxes, the Jewish temple, and homes, the forest was not native to Israel. Yet God is creator of the cedar, and God can transplant the cedar wherever God wishes. And God can create a kingdom or a temple wherever God wishes. Although God tried to nourish the cedar planted in that place in Lebanon, it wasn't honored there. So God vowed to transplant the mighty cedar to the Mount Zion in Israel, where it would grow so tall as to tower over all of the other trees of every land, so that all would know that God is Lord, and that the lowly, Israel, might be made the tallest and mightiest in the land, the cedar in Israel, which is really God's power through Israel. The Lord brings down the tall tree and makes the low tree grow tall. I dry up the green tree and make the dry tree flourish. Although the cedar tree, as a metaphor, signifies greatness, mighty strength, power, height, astounding growth, it is the metaphor that people in Ezekiel's time would have understood the most. And they would have been stunned by the very idea that a Lebanon cedar could even be grown on the little hill in Israel, where it wouldn't have enough water to sustain it, let alone to grow to such heights. But God prevails, not by power, not by might, but by the Spirit, says the Lord. God can grow anything God wants to, anytime and anywhere, and in any condition, and with any people. And it will spread out its branches, says Ezekiel, and bear fruit, and the birds of every kind will nest and perch in it. Israel would become a destination for all people who could put down roots there safely and securely under God's care and reign. That's the nesting part. But Jesus tells a different parable. Jesus re-images Ezekiel's parable of the cedar and doesn't just change the focus, but changes the tree itself. Now when we look at the painting, God provides, we no longer see the tall, sturdy, thick, stable cedar tree on the hill, the symbol of powerful and temple-centered homeland Israel. In its place, we see a lowly, spindly, wily, common mustard seed, native to the fields of the Mediterranean basin, not a cultivated tree or a stately tree, but essentially an insidious weed, capable of germinating quickly and pervasively, traveling far and wide, in which perhaps a bird could perch, but definitely not make a permanent home. This is a traveling plant, a plant with no definite place as its home or root, but a plant that can exist in any place or clime, can put down roots in every soil or culture, in every heart. It's a pilgrim plant, for the seed planted is the primary metaphor of God's inscription upon the heart, the seed of the Torah planted within the human heart, not on a hill, but in a field. And all spreading wildly from one very tiny, minuscule seed. For it only takes a spark to kindle the holy fire of faith within every heart. Whether rich or poor, Greek or Jew, common or not, for all are in common in the Lord's vineyard. For Jesus, the smallest of seeds, not just Israel, but the smallest of people, the least of these, the outcast and the lonely are the common, the most humble, will germinate the greatest of faith. And the field weed will become the largest of the garden plants, a tree in which birds can perch, can find footing in the scriptures of Israel. From the temple of Israel to the heart of Israel, this is the promise of God. The kingdom, says Jesus, is not the temple in Jerusalem. The kingdom of Israel is the state of your own heart. So I guess my question to you is, how is your garden growing? How is the state of your soul? You don't need to be powerful, to have great status, or even be of a certain place or a people to be a child of God. All you need is faith, and what was small will grow large within you. The mustard may not be the prettiest tree or the tallest or the strongest physically, but it has the generating power of an uncontained virus and the hardiness of yeast. And it will never be contained. And it will never lose faith or become unrooted from the one true God, but will reproduce that strength of faith in all future peoples and generations. And as for me, this is my covenant with them, says the Lord. My spirit that is upon you and my words that I have put in your mouth shall not depart out of your mouth or out of the mouth of your offspring or out of the mouth of your children's offspring, says the Lord, from this time forth and forevermore. The people in Jesus' time were mustard people. Jesus knew this. Jesus re-imaged their perspective to understand that God's love and mercy was to be given to all people of all places and cultures. Today, perhaps we'd be a thistle people, or recalling last week's sermon, a dandelion people. Or perhaps we'd be a viral people, or a social media thumbs up people. But no matter what your metaphor, the image Jesus presents us with is one of God's everlasting love and mercy, known and acknowledged not just by one people, but by a faithful people. People who are called to spread that love to all cultures, all peoples, and throughout all generations in every way possible. That's a world re-imaged in the image of Jesus. Amen. So let us further respond to the word of God as we come together in prayer. During these prayers, I invite you to respond to the words, Lord of all creation, will you say, teach us your ways? To the words, Lord of all creation, will you say, teach us your ways? And so Jesus, the teacher, enables the ordinary, unlearned people to understand God's wisdom, the eternal laws of his Father's kingdom. Let us come before him in prayer. May the Spirit pray through us as we try to put into words the longing of our hearts for the church and for this world. Loving God, we thank you for all who have helped us to pray and to grasp something of your great love and power. We ask your blessing and empowering for all who teach and minister in your name. We ask for our Sunday worship to be an overflowing of our daily walk with you, an expression of our deepening love. Lord of all creation, teach us your ways. Loving God, we thank you for the beauty and diversity of the created world we inhabit. We ask for the wisdom to tend it carefully, respecting the natural laws and sharing the resources, listening to the weak as well as the strident, the poor as well as the affluent and powerful. Lord of all creation, teach us your ways. Loving God, we thank you for the candor and innocence of the very young, and for the joy of friendship, and for all with whom we share our daily life, and those we love but seldom meet. We ask for hearts that are skilled in listening, so that we discern and respond to the real agendas, and remember that a conversation is a two-way event. Lord of all creation, teach us your ways. Father, we thank you for the advances in medical knowledge and the hope for new treatments for many diseases, in particular the work that is being done to find a vaccine for this COVID virus. We pray for all in medical research, and all whose lives are crippled or disadvantaged by illness, frailty, or damage. Give comfort and reassurance, healing, wholeness, and peace. Lord of all creation, teach us your ways. Loving God, we call to mind all those we have known and loved who lived among us and have now died. We pray for all who made that journey unnoticed and alone. We ask that they may all know your mercy and the everlasting peace and joy of heaven. Lord of all creation, teach us your ways. Loving God, we thank you for your wisdom and truth, your understanding and generosity. We acknowledge our total dependence on you and praise you for providing us with all that we need. And so, merciful God, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you. So now, as is our way during online worship, I would ask members and friends of the church to please let us know in the comments section of your presence with us and how many were watching with you at this time. I'd also remind you that you can continue your giving to the church ministries online through the website using the Giving tab or by posting your contribution check to the church office. Just a note, there will be no meet with the minister this Wednesday. No meeting this Wednesday. If you're not a member of the church and are a regular viewer, or you have found us for the first time today, then thank you for joining us. Please do let us know how we can get in touch with you, as we have a small gift that we'd like to send you as a welcome to our congregation. You can email the church office at rpoffice@robertspark.org, robertsparkumc.org, and we will add you to our midweek mailing. I'd also encourage you to follow us on Facebook and subscribe to our church YouTube channel. And now, go forth with joy, celebrating all the many ways for us to serve our Lord. Give us courage, hope, and peace and love that we might bear these gifts to others. Go in peace, and may the God of peace go with you. Amen.